has promised, Son of God and Son of Man. Heaven's glory in a manger has come to us in Bethlehem.
Tear to your eye right there. Christmas is a high time. It's a time that we celebrate, of course, Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus Christ coming to this earth. I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 2. We are able to see just in video portion and story Matthew's account and, of course, the wise men, which was just a few years later from the birth. But stand together, please, reading God's word in Luke chapter 2 and pick up reading verse number 7 there. We've been in a series, Christmas Lights, and this morning I want to speak about this subject, the gift of light, and just kind of pull in some of the things that were said just a moment ago. In that one song, the choir was singing, Behold a Savior, there was a line in there that said this, Holy child that ends our night and brings to us his great light. I am thankful for the light that came to this earth in Jesus Christ. And I want to talk just a little bit about that idea. Pick up reading verse number 7, Luke's Gospel chapter 2. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, an angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. I'll draw your attention to our text verse number 11. Let's read that out loud together in unison. Verse 11, ready? For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. I want to remind you of a verse of Scripture in John chapter 8, verse 12 that says this, Then spake Jesus again of them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. I want to speak on that subject just about the gift of light. Father, thank you for your word. Challenge us with this truth today. Thank you for what we've been able to witness in song and script, and I pray you'll bless your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Last week we started this sermon series, and this thought was given, Jesus is the light of the world. How many believe that? Say amen. Amen. Jesus is the light of the world. He came into this dark, dreary world to save sinners and to direct people to eternal life in heaven. And light is such a powerful gift. As our Heavenly Father created this world, on day one He created light. And now, even with the sun going down at night, we have light at our fingertips. And by the way, never get weary of the sun coming up, sunrise and sunset, because that great light of sun in the sky should remind us that God is our creator. But now we have light at our fingertips. We have headlights on our cars. We even have flashlights on our cell phones. And who knows, next place we'll have, my wife has a pair of glasses that has lights right there on them for reading. And who knows where we'll have lights next. But, you know, it seems that the world lights up at Christmas. Did you see the smiles on these children's faces today? And the reason for that is Jesus is the light of the world. We sing songs like Silent Night, Holy Night, and sometimes we sing them gloomy, but the song is not about gloom at all. It's not about night or darkness. It's about light. The rest of the song goes, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus Christ is the light. We sing this song, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And we say, Hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. You see, Christmas is all about Jesus and being the light of the world. We sing at Christmas because we have something to sing about. And I want you to have something to sing about at Christmas. These old songs we sing light us up. Light has come into the world, and we never need to walk in darkness again because Jesus is that light. May I say that God intended for that light to be a gift for mankind. Just a couple of quick things by way of introduction. The Bible says that God is light. 1 John 1:5. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Think about that statement. God is light. The Bible is called light in the scriptures. It guides us into life, into eternal life. Psalm 119:106. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And if you get that place in life where you just don't know where to turn, understand that God gives us guidance in the Word of God. The gospel is described as light. The death, burial, and resurrection shows us the way to heaven. But even more so, Jesus Christ is called the light of the world. And this is the greatest light that we could ever be given as human beings. For it is by this light, Jesus Christ, that we will ultimately find our way to eternal life in heaven. By the way, how many want to go to heaven someday? And the thought of that precious gift of eternal life came through the gift of God's Son, Jesus. Now, I'd like to take us back for just a moment to that day that this light entered the world at Bethlehem, Judea. And I want to first say this, because our culture in America, Western culture, is getting away from this. I want to say this profoundly, and that is this. Christmas really did happen. Amen. That first Christmas we've been seeing on the video and so forth, singing about, we read about it here in Luke's gospel. We could read about it in Matthew's gospel, chapter 1. It's prophesied over 300 times in the Old Testament about the Lord's birth, his life, and his death, and so forth. So we come to this text this morning in verse number 11, and it says that the Christ child was given. I want you to notice, first of all, in our text today, that Jesus Christ is God's gift to mankind. Write that down and think about that. Jesus Christ is God's gift to mankind. Notice the verse the Bible says in verse 11, "For unto us," think about that, how personal that is, "for unto us is born this day." There was a day, I don't know if it's December 25th or not, but there was a day that God sent his son to be born of a virgin on this planet, and thank God for that day. That was a gift. "For unto us a child is born." Isaiah 9 said it like this in verse 6. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall rest upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." With Jesus Christ comes light. With Jesus Christ comes peace to this earth, and thank God for that. The Lord Jesus Christ came wrapped, the Bible says, in swaddling clothes. That little bundle of joy was God's gift intended to change the world. Later, after Joseph and Mary had settled into their house in Jerusalem, which was depicted in the video, the wise men came from the east, following the light of the star, bringing gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And by the way, I'm glad Nick got that little analogy about M is for mercy and F is for faith and G is for gold, whatever all that meant. But I like that part. But I just want to say that Jesus Christ was God's gift to mankind. You see, God has given us much more than this world has to offer. God gave himself. I read a story the other day about a young boy named Gabriel Hurls. He was 6 years old a few years back, and he was celebrating his birthday around Christmas time. We have some in here today whose birthday actually falls on Christmas. And I thought, what a bummer that would be, all of it one time, you know. You like mine's in June, so I get to split it up, you know. But this young boy's birthday was somewhere close to Christmas, and he was eating his birthday cake that day on his birthday, and he was so focused on his birthday cake there and the candles and blowing them out that he didn't even notice a giant package in the corner of the room. Another child that was at his party pointed out the large gift standing in the corner there, and Gabriel ran over and began to tear off the wrapping paper, and to his surprise, it wasn't a bicycle or any large gift like that, but the six-year-old got exactly what he wanted that day, because inside that large gift was his father, Army Specialist Casey Hurls, who was home from leave from the war. Can you just imagine the tears and the jubilation, the light up of that little boy's face when his daddy was inside that package? Can I say that if we look at Christmas this way, that Jesus Christ was not just that baby born in the manger, that Jesus Christ was a Son of God that came to this world to take away your sin and my sin. And thank God for that great gift. Not only was Jesus Christ God's gift to man, but Jesus Christ, the Bible says, is our Savior in verse 11. It says, and for unto us is born this day in the city of David, circle this phrase, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. The choir was singing about Messiah. That was the Jewish name for Jesus Christ, the anointed one that the Bible said would come to save his people. And by the way, not just the Jewish race, but he came to save all of mankind if we put our faith and trust in him. Jesus Christ has not come to be a Savior, but was born our Savior and King. And Jesus is here right now. How many believe that? And Jesus can be accepted or rejected. And sadly, much of the world rejects Jesus Christ today. We have a chance to accept him as our Lord and Savior. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21 says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." You know, today people will often push back at any attempt from another person to give them the gospel. Sometimes they'll make a statement like this. They'll say, "Well, becoming a Christian is a very personal thing." And by the way, that's a very true statement. It's meant to be personal. When a person is confronted with the fact that they're sinners and their sin will take them to hell when they die someday, that's a very personal thing when you think about it. And in order for you to confront that, you're going to have to say with the apply, in order to be saved, I, it's personal, I am a sinner. It's personal in that once we realize that we're sinners, and the Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. Isaiah said all of our righteousness are as filthy rags. When we get to the place we realize that we cannot go to heaven on our good works, and we understand that we're all sinners, we're all born into sin from Adam's race. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered in the world, and death by sin, so then death is passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. The moment we realize we're a sinner, then we got to say this, I. It's personal. I need a Savior. I need somebody to save me. I'm thinking about when you, maybe if you fall into a river of what rushing water, unable to swim, you don't need a teacher. You don't need a politician. You don't need some doctor somewhere. You don't need someone to coddle you and make you feel better about yourself. What you need is a Savior, or you're never going to get out of the rushing water. The same is true with our sins today. In this dark world, Jesus Christ came into this world to save sinners. And lastly, number three, Jesus Christ brings great joy. And I guess I said all this to get to this. I love Christmas. I've always loved Christmas. I was raised in a little town in West Virginia, and I can remember coming out on Christmas morning. We always had Christmas on Christmas morning, and it would just kind of build and build and build. And, you know, we didn't get much back then, but to open up a present or two underneath that tree, it was just so exciting for a child. You know, we talk about Christmas bringing great joy, and we often call happy moments light moments. We'll use the word. They were so delighted. And speaking of lighting up, and you know, when new babies are born, that really lights things up. I'm a pastor, so I get to go to the hospital all the time. I was just there this week, and a new baby was born, and man, the room was just lit up with joy. And you know, you got this baby here and crying and needs taking care of it. Everybody's so happy. There you go. I heard that baby cry. Amen. Everybody's just so happy about that. And boy, that was of the Lord, wasn't it? Huh? We just light up. And can I just say that Jesus Christ, this was no ordinary baby. He was a gift, and he brought with him a gift to this world. And that gift is eternal life. God wants to give you and I eternal life. As a little boy, when I got saved, that was just something special. When I realized that I could believe in Jesus Christ, and then I could live forever and ever and ever because of God's Son. All this excitement started on that countryside there with the shepherds, as talked about here in these passages. We'll not go look at all of them, but I mean, that countryside lit up at the birth of God's Son. It started with the angels, verses 9 and 13 and 14. The word glory is used in verse 9. It is a Greek word, doxa. Very unusual word. It means a full emphasis on the position of a person. A full emphasis on the position of a person. We sing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. The emphasis is on the position of God. God is the giver of all gifts, but the greatest gift, Jesus Christ. And in other words, these angels that were singing in these verses, God's messengers, were lighting up the sky with the brilliance and splendor of God's presence, so much so that it was unmistakable to these shepherds there. Not only to start with the angels, but it moved to the shepherds in verses 15 through 20. Now the angels were made to praise God. It was pretty easy for them. But the shepherds didn't quite feel the same way immediately. In fact, the Bible says that they were sore afraid. That's a phrase which means they were completely terrified with what they were seeing. And by the way, in Bible times, shepherds were looked down upon as second-class citizens. And after they got over the shock of the brilliance of the sky, of all these angels which were in the presence of God, they saw all of that glory. They were probably wondering, well, why us? Who would ever believe us with this powerful message? But after the angels' spectacular production on that night, the Bible says that they made haste to go see the baby. In other words, they were in a hurry. They were moving on because they want everybody to hear about what they were able to see with their eyes. Verse 17 states that after they left the stable that night, they went everywhere telling folks about this new Savior. I'm just saying, the sky lit up with those angels, and then the lives of those shepherds lit up. And the Bible says in verse number 18,
And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. And we understand that that light affected all that heard. They wondered, which means they marveled, they were amazed. And even to this day, as I listen to the song, I listen to the script on the video, as I watch the kids, tears fill my eyes of the wonder of Christmas. As we were praying back in the prayer room before we came out, I had to stop and just say, Lord, we really don't understand how great this day was when Jesus Christ came to this earth to save sinners. Thank God, for unto us a child is born, and we have a Savior now, Christ the Lord. Amen. Down through time, lives have been changed one at a time as they saw the light of Jesus Christ. They understood the gospel, and they believed on Him for salvation. It's a simple thing. May I say in closing this, the life and the light went out of Adam's race when you sinned the Garden of Eden. But I'm thankful that our Heavenly Father, our Creator, did not leave it that way. Jesus now is the light of the world. When we make Christ, Jesus Christ, both Lord and Savior, the one who entered time and space as a little babe in Bethlehem comes in, He turns on the light. He lightens up our soul. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Something changes inside of us. It's something that folks just can't believe could ever happen. But the Word of God says that He can make that which is old new. He lights us up because Jesus is the light of the world. No matter how cold and dark your world may seem, it can be brought back to life when the glorious light of the Son of God shines in your heart. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no life without light. Physically, no light, no life. And there is no eternal life without Jesus Christ. The gospel is called the light. The Bible is described as light. The gospel is simply this: the death of Jesus Christ, His burial for 3 days, and His resurrection. The Bible says this: if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Not maybe, not if you get lucky you'll get in. Thou shalt be saved. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth and believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, that is Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Do you all think you can quote with me John 3:16? Let's try it together in unison. Would you do that? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. That is one of the most profound and well-known verses in all the Scriptures, because it contains great truth and a great promise that if we'll believe in Jesus Christ, we shall be saved. My friend, if you've never believed and put your faith and trust in Christ, I want to challenge you to do that today. We'll have like a little invitation here if we could for just a moment. I'd like for us to bow our heads for just a while. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, and no one's looking around. This is not a time when we would embarrass anybody at all, but it is a time of decision. We've heard some beautiful, powerful music. We've read from the Scriptures one more time how Christmas really did happen, how God sent His Son to this earth to die on the cross for our sins. It's the old, old story we were singing about. And my friend, today, if you'll put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, if you'll just believe that, you can be saved. You know, it's a strange thing. In America, probably more people believe in George Washington, that he was a true figure in history, than they do with Jesus Christ. It's kind of sad because no one except his age, his generations, ever saw George Washington, but they believe in George Washington. Can we not have that mustard seed faith that believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, as mentioned in Scriptures? Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. We read the Word of God. Could we not have that grain of faith that says Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that Jesus Christ did die for my sins on the cross, that He was buried for 3 days, and He got out of the grave? If you can believe that today, you can be saved. Thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead,
thou shalt be saved. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed, I want to ask you a question today. I wonder who'd say this, preacher, I'm saved, I know I'm saved, I got that all settled today. I know if I die to go to heaven. Would you put your hand up real high? I got that all settled, Dave. I know I'm saved. I got that all settled today. God bless you. Thank you. Put your hands down. I was saved as a young boy. Growing up, my parents kept us in church. And I remember the day that I bowed my head as a young boy and prayed and asked him to save me. My friend, I want to ask you to do that today. If you could not raise your hand right there, I want to help you right here. I can tell you the prayer that I prayed, and I prayed this with hundreds of people. We call it the sinner's prayer, but folks, it's a very, very important moment. You do not know when you'll have another chance to receive Christ as your Savior. If you'll believe that Jesus died for your sins, was buried 3 days, if you'll believe he got out of the grave the third day, and if you'll pray and receive him, confess him with your mouth, believe in your heart, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I want to help you call on his name right now. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed, no one looking, I want to help you. This is what I'm a gospel preacher. I want to help you make that decision if you've never done it. Here's the prayer. I want to invite you, if you'll trust Christ as your Savior today, if you want to become a born-again Christian, if you want to become a believer in Christ today, you got to call on his name. And I'm going to help you call on his name right now. If you'll pray this and mean this in your heart, you can be a born-again Christian. Here's the prayer. Our heads are bowed. Let's pray it together. Lord Jesus, I realize I'm a sinner. I believe you died for me on the cross for my sins. I believe that you were buried for 3 days. And I believe you rose again from the grave. Lord, I ask you now to forgive me my sins. Come into my life. Make me a Christian. In Jesus' name I pray. I want to pray that. Make sure you got that. I want to help you with this. And here it is again. I want you to pray with me if you've never trusted Christ. I invite you to do that. Lord Jesus, I realize that I'm a sinner. And I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you were buried for 3 days. And I believe that you rose again from the grave. And you're alive right now. Lord, I ask you to forgive me my sins and come into my life and make me a Christian. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, with our heads bowed, our eyes closed, I'm looking. I want to ask you right now. And I promise you, I would not come to you, would not embarrass you. If you prayed that prayer and you meant that in your heart, you wanted to be a born-again Christian, or did you lift your hand just as a testimony, I prayed that, I want to be saved, just put your hand right up, right back down, I'm looking on my right, God bless you. I prayed that, I meant that, God bless you, sir, yes, sir. I prayed, I'm looking right down the middle, I prayed that, I meant that, I want to be a Christian. I prayed that, just put your hand right up, right back down, I'll see that. I prayed that prayer, I meant that, I want to be a Christian. Let's stand to our feet, please, with our heads bowed, our eyes closed. We'll have the choir sing a hymn of invitation here today. There's not a lot of room up front here, but maybe there's another need that you came and you carried a heavy load in this church today. This is a dark and dreary world, but it doesn't have to be that way. Jesus Christ is the light. And I want to invite you to come to the Lord today. Maybe I did not see your hand. Maybe there's some of you that God's working with today, and this is the invitation today. If you're not sure that heaven's your home, we'll have somebody standing at the end of each aisle with a Bible in their hand. They love to take that Bible today. They love to take a few moments and show you exactly what I just showed you and pray with you, and you can come to Christ today. Today, if you're saved and you've not been baptized, we'd love to help you with that. These men will talk you through every bit of that. If you're a man will talk with you. If you're a lady, they'll give you a lady to talk with you. Today, if you'd like to join our church, we'd love to have you come. This is our invitation. If God's speaking in your heart, something you want to pray about today, we want you to come. Father, bless as we sing this invitation song. Speak to hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're singing now. You come, would you?
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you.
may be seated. Father, thank you again for your word today. Thank you for what we've been able to hear in song and witness. Thank you for the glorious event of your coming over 2,000 years ago. We rejoice today. May we enter into this Christmas season. Great celebration in our hearts for all you've done for us. Bless these who lift their hand for salvation today and others whose hearts you're working on. I pray that you'll just continue to work and bless, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you so much for coming today. First of all, I want to thank the choir and all the orchestra and everybody who put time in this. Let's give them a good thank you again. Would you do that? God bless you all. I always enjoyed hearing our choir and orchestra, and they did a fantastic job again. They are children as well, and we're thankful for that. I'll take just a moment and show you what's coming up next here at our church.
Thanks for joining us as we highlight some upcoming opportunities for you to connect with us here at Franklin Road Baptist Church.
Visiting a new church can be uncomfortable and sometimes a little confusing. Where do I take my kids? How do I get connected with others? What's my next step? We would love the privilege to get to know you and help you get to know our church. Simply complete the connection card found in today's bulletin and bring it to the main lobby after today's service, where we look forward to meeting you and presenting you with a free gift as a thank you for being with us today.
Just like you, your kids have similar interests when it comes to church. They want a place where they can worship God and grow in Him, but they also want to do so with a kid-level energy with other kids their same age. FRBC Kids creates this exciting environment for children while providing them with the chance to worship and hear biblical teaching and preaching relevant to their particular age group. Programs are available for kids of all ages, so be sure to get your child plugged into FRBC Kids today.
Our Christmas at Franklin Road season concludes with a very special Christmas Eve service. Enjoy singing Christmas carols, hearing the Christmas story, and reflecting on the miracle of Christ's birth as we celebrate Christmas one last time as a church family. We hope you will join us for this year's Christmas Eve service at Franklin Road.
You can learn more about our church by seeing today's bulletin, connecting with us online, or by stopping by the information desk in the lobby. Thanks again for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you again soon right here at Franklin Road Baptist Church.
All right, let's all stand together. We'll sing a Going Home song, and we'd love to meet you in the lobby out there. And then also, we want to welcome Oksana Kennedy right over here. And she's been saved and baptized. They're coming to our church by transfer of letter. Are you rejoicing her being here? Would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. You're amen in, Oksana. God bless you. Good to see you. And my wife and I will meet you out. Let's sing together.
All right. And if you have children in the service today, they weren't in the children's service, we do have gifts for them in the lobby as well. If you want to stop by in that area, we'd love to give those to them. Let's sing together. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. Just that chorus.
Oh, come, let us adore.
Service is 6:30. God bless you. Have a wonderful afternoon.